Looks good? Alright, so it's gonna go ahead and start recording, and I'll try to figure out a good introduction and BS mode. Alright, I'm super exhausted.
Oh, hi.
Just look at the camera. I mean, or look at me when I'm talking, then you can look at the camera. Alright, you guys ready?
Yep.
Ready? Alright, do you have a good shot where you can see me?
Yep.
Okay. Hey everybody, welcome to MogTalk at FanFest 2016 in Las Vegas. This is a very special episode with lots of noise in the background. How loud is it getting on the mic, by the way? Is it pretty bad? It's coming through.
We're going to wait till they're done sound checking.
They're never going to be done sound checking.
Welcome everyone. Today should be October 22nd for you, 2016. I'm Frosty, and today we will be having our FanFest special episode. This is an offline recorded episode. Hopefully it doesn't take away from the show too much today. As you can see, I'm moving the camera around behind me. This is kind of when we're at the event. I just kind of filmed sections of the event for you guys to see. There's going to be two different parts of the show today. There's going to be, first, my experiences with FanFest. Then there's going to be, second, the short show I made with three awesome Elysium players. Gouka, the leader of Elysium, Layla, and Balana. They all sat down with me in the hotel, and we recorded a short little show just about their experiences with FanFest. And this was right before the Primals concert, so it's when it was all kind of fresh to them. I was planning to do a little bit more with FanFest for MogTalk, but it was so insanely hectic. In the end, I just decided against doing more than what we actually did. There's a ton of things, which I'll tell you about as we go throughout the show today. But, you know, without any further ado, let me just go ahead and give you a quick summary of what FanFest really was like. It was amazing. I mean, 10 out of 10, definitely would do it again. The biggest highlights, of course, being that we could meet the community. So many people came up and talked to us and said, hi, how are you doing? We were making new friends. We were watching the panels together and just doing the events. I mean, it was great to do all that. The concerts, amazing. Every night we had one concert. I mean, it was two nights, so each night we had a concert. Also, there were some issues. There was the merch line. Merch line was horrible, which, of course, I'm sure everybody's heard about now. Some of the hired Vegas staff, not the people who work in the company with Square Enix, but some of the just temp workers that was there working a convention, they were not great. Some of them were fine at points, but if you went behind the scenes, they were like pushing each other, acting like idiots, and it was gross. I mean, the activity rewards for even dealing with these Vegas staff when you would go and do some of the events weren't great. You got a stamp in a book. I mean, it just was kind of ridiculous. And you would go turn it in, and eventually you got a little paper triple triad card, and that was basically all you got. But let's go into it a little bit more. I want to talk first about meeting the community. It was absolutely great. So let me change the scene up here a little bit. Okay, so I shrunk myself down a little bit here, so you can get a little bit of perspective. I'm going to start this back up here, and you can kind of see, when you go out, look at these people just kind of talking and hanging around, and just saying, hey, what's up, how you doing? Some of them look a little bit grumpy, because this is part of the merch line, so if you look a little bit up there, you can see some of those grumpy faces, but, I mean, it's just hanging out. doing what you do. It was wonderful to go out and see these people. And there's so many people here came up and said hi to me. And I was like, holy shit, people actually know who I am. That was an amazing factor that I'm never, ever going to get anywhere else, ever. But just a group of nerds playing Final Fantasy XIV, me being one of the biggest ones, and just talking about this stuff. Where else am I going to get this? It happens every 2 years. And so when anyone says, oh, I don't know, I'm thinking about going to FanFest. If you like Final Fantasy XIV at all, why are you not here hanging out with these people? Look at this guy. This is Argent. He's in my static. I would have never met this guy at all. And I would have never known the person that he was unless I actually went to this event. Look at his shirt, by the way. It's that Sephiroth kind of shirt. It looks like supposed to be like a Star Wars crossover with Final Fantasy VII. It was amazing. But yeah, I mean, this is another huge part of the event that you would have missed, that you missed out on if you didn't go. So if you didn't make this one, please try to make it for, you know, 2018, probably for the next one, whatever the next expansion is coming out. So let's go on to the next part here. All right. So the other really cool part about Final Fantasy XIV FanFest is you have all these people here lining up ready to watch a panel. And this was right before the announcement for Stormblood came out. And you have all these people just kind of hanging out. Man, what does that guy have on his head? That's kind of at the bottom of the center of the screen. Whatever. You just won't pay attention to it. You got people in Moogle outfits over here. You can see the fat Chocobo kind of far off in the distance up there. And you see that one spot in the middle there. That's actually where they were recording some of the stream kind of conversations that they were having, little mini interviews and everything. And they had TVs posted everywhere, so no matter where you were sitting, you were getting a good view. They had panels about lore. Koji is absolutely amazing at talking. He has a wonderful personality, especially when he's up in front of a giant audience. Soken does really well when he talks about music, although he didn't have any panels this year except for, you know, the concert, which he did amazing at. Then they had a little bit of a battle system discussion with one of the people they called Mr. Ozma there. And he was awesome to listen to. And he discussed kind of the future of some of the things that he would want to do as well. They also had panels. All right, so there was another panel that was a Q&A panel. And people, they went out in the crowd and just let people ask whatever. That's please look forward to it, is I think what the panel was called. And they had people kind of run up to people in the crowd and say, hey, what's your question for Yoshi? And you could ask kind of whatever you wanted to ask. If I bet you guys could guess what was asked the most. It was about hairstyles and glamour. Come on, guys. I was sitting there waving my arms, going crazy, insane. I was like, please ask me my question so I can get some rating answers, something else going on. But, you know, that's the people in the crowd who were picked. Their questions were answered, and maybe they feel good about knowing the future of hairstyles in Final Fantasy XIV. I'm not going to throw any more salt on that. That's it. But yeah, I mean, all these panels were nice to listen to. I mean, if you had, especially if you aren't doing anything with your friends, you can come over and catch it. So I think they did a really good job this year of panels. I would have, again, preferred to be able to have some more better questions answered. They also did a PvP expedition, which I was in, and I lost due to my inability to know which direction was my base. But, I mean, it was fun. There was a lot of hype going in the crowd, and I think that was done really well. But, yeah, so let's go on to the next part here. All right, so they had a ton of events out there, one of them being Any Way to Win Blows, where everyone just kind of, you know, the event in Gold Saucer where you go in a circle, and then if you don't stop on the right area, you get blown off. And they do kind of the same thing here. And it was kind of interesting to watch. I mean, they also had the little spear where you throw spears out and try to make it into a hole. Oh, see, some people just got knocked out. It was kind of fun, right? It was kind of interesting. Nothing you can do about it. If you won, you just got an extra stamp. And I'll go more into stamps. Let me go ahead and pause this real quick. All right, so the stamps sucked. All right, so they gave you a book. And if you won something, you got an extra stamp in there. If you didn't win something, you got one stamp. in the end, it didn't matter where they stamped in the book at all, if it was under the right event, if it was not under the right event, because eventually you start getting this overflood of stamps, and they're like, well, I'll just say you won the other one over here, and they don't know what to do. Oh, you fill up all your stamps, let's go to the back page and just stamp some more. They're not going to mean anything, but they make it seem like it does, and that was kind of disappointing. I think that whole area kind of sucked, because they could have done a lot more with the events in general. Where you actually were getting rewards like t-shirts, which was one of the biggest complaints. I didn't get a t-shirt for doing my events. Okay, kind of makes sense, right? The other thing was you didn't get poster. Okay, granted, Feast. You'd get a poster out of Feast if you won on that one, but it was easy to win because only half of the Feast was lined up. That went really quick. I don't know why Feast didn't get more attention, because it was really fun to actually just sit there and kill people. And actually, like, a handful of groups just sat there at the Feast computers, and just anyone who came, they would just play them and just keep playing them, because it was a good time sink. But yeah, there was a lot of these events you could go do with your friends and everything else. One of my favorite was Any Way to Win Blows, but they also had one where you were shooting like a Nerf gun, trying to knock things down like a machinist. And then they had, you know, again, the tossing spear thing, which is supposed to be kind of, I guess, the Dragoon part. I've put all the Nerf little things, like he's holding one right now, but all the little Nerf spears kind of got bent and screwed up pretty quickly. Then they had, of course, the Madruga toss, where you're kind of just playing basketball, and whoever got the most in out of the four people going would get a whatever you call it, a stamp in it. But they had other events in there, like they had, what was another event they had in? Okay, so Proto Ultima, and a lot of people, by the way, complained about Proto Ultima, because they thought it wasn't really that interesting. They thought, it was too easy. But then, think about it, man, when you're making an event, and it's for something like FanFest, where you have a mixture of like really good players and just fans, not really great players, just people who love Final Fantasy. If you make something too difficult and it's a 24-man event, then you're going to have people who are upset because they had to wait in line for something and then they lost. And here's the other part of it. If you did an event and it was too hard and you wanted to succeed at it, you would jump back in line. And now, in the end, that line for Proto Ultima was non-existent. You could just walk up there and just wait for more people to come up, and eventually you could do the event. And that was kind of a good thing, because that meant that you, if it was too hard, people would come back in line and wait. And so you had more and more backlog of players, and so you're always waiting in this big line, which is something that happened with the Extreme Roulettes. It was the only one that had a really bad line in there, because they had some ridiculous challenges in there. I think my group waited for about an hour and a half to get into the event, and once we got in there and we sat down, we set up all of our controls and everything, we had to do Nidhogg normal, but it was with first person, and unfortunately some of the people weren't as familiar with the fight, and when you do first person Nidhogg, you can't see Nidhogg. He's invisible because he's so big that when you zoom in that close, his whole avatar just disappears. And so you're not able to see the ground AoEs as much. You're not able to see all this other stuff that's going on. And people would just die and it would snowball. And I think we tried three or four times and then we're like, yep, you got to go. So that kind of sucked. But of course, people would keep going through that because they wanted just to beat it with their group. And that caused a long line. Everything else had a pretty quick line. Like these mini games, you only had to wait in line for like 10, 15 minutes until they were done. So that kind of worked out well. It's kind of weird how to control lines. If you make things too easy, then no one's doing it. If you make things too hard, then everyone's going to keep doing it and it's going to suck. You don't want to sit around in an event like FanFest waiting in line, which is brings me to my next point, the merchandise line. So let me switch over again here. Hold on 1 second. Okay, so here is when the event opened up. And it was kind of good, but this is a line for the merchandise line. The merchandise area is on the other side of the room, the very far corner of the room. And I was going to stand in the merchandise line, but I said, you know what, this wouldn't make any sense at all. Yeah, that guy's a little bit confused about what I'm doing. He's like, this is awkward and weird. That's Kerr and my little group over there. Eventually, I found out, while in this line on a complete tangent here, those wonderful Vegas staff members, they were waiting to do stuff. So, you know, they're like, screw it, man. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to play basketball. I'm going to sit here and just kind of throw basketballs the entire time. And I believe I turned, yeah, after I see this, I'm like, whoa, what's going on over there? And I move over there. But come on, move out of the way. Move out of the way. Sorry, you guys noticed the offline recorded episode, but it's completely poorly produced here. All right. So, yeah, I'm moving the camera over here just so I can get a good shot. This is, by the way, in the forefront of all this. This is the Proto Ultima event. They had tons of computers line up for people to do this, and so people just easily went through the event, and they were done after a bit here. Okay, I guess that was it. Let's go back here, because I had it earlier. Yeah. Right here, you can just see that those event staff way in the back just throwing the Madruga, whatever, balls into the net. And it was just kind of fascinating for me to see that at the very beginning. Because they're bored, they don't know what to do. Those guys, I think, were mostly the Vegas hired staff, and they weren't actually people who worked for Square Enix. And they were absolutely horrible. But let me get back to the merchandise line. So the merchandise line, we're dealing with the people who were standing where we are right now. Spent 7 hours in line. Not an exaggeration. 7 hours to get to the merchandise booth. There are people who are after it, and they were like, this is the cutoff point. We can't have any more people here. And they gave them tickets and said, you have to come back tomorrow. Now, granted, that worked out fine. The next day with merchandise, people came in with their tickets and they just call them by group. They said, hey, you have to line up at this point, and at a certain point, we're just going to cut it off and we won't accept anyone else to try to buy merchandise. So they would show up, they got tickets, and they went around the event and they enjoyed themselves. And at a certain time, tickets were being called to go up there, I suppose. And then you would go over to the merchandise line and get your stuff. And that was a pretty good system. It worked out pretty well. It went throughout the entire day, and people got what they needed to. But this first part was horrible. And I'm curious. Okay, so I want to give the benefit of the doubt to everyone who set up this event with Merchandise Line. Because I know for a fact it was a priority. It was something that they said, hey, we're going to have a good Merchandise Line because it was bad last time. And this is something we want to improve upon. But this year was worse. And I don't know what the exact faults were, and I'm hoping I'm going to be able to go back and talk to Matt and everyone else and say, hey, so what was the deal? What happened? And they'll have something. This wasn't something like, hey, we just don't know what we're doing. It's something like, hey, we had a system, we were going to do something, and it was going to work out pretty well, but it all failed. And I want to see where that came from. And there's lots of suggestions for how they could kind of fix it and go forward in the future. And hopefully, you know, they're going to improve upon it. And next time, it's not going to be a big deal. But yeah, merchandise line sucked. One of the major downfalls of the entire event. But let me go on to this next section here. We've already talked about the three things I hated the most, which is the merchandise line, the hired Vegas staff, and the activity rewards, which no one was really excited for. So let's go back into some of these things that I thought were absolutely amazing. The concerts were worth the FanFest alone ticket. Going out and seeing the piano concert and the Primal concert. Now, people who are musicians might be a little bit picky about some of the things they did, but I didn't notice it. I'm not a musician. I didn't notice anything that was a little bit different or a little bit off. It all sounded great to me. It sounded a little bit grungy at the Primal concert, and the piano concert was just relaxing and beautiful. I thought it was done pretty well. And Soken came on during the piano concert, and he was kicking a box and had some bells on his leg and tried to emulate sound in one of the songs, and I thought it was absolutely fantastic what he did. Let's see. Give me one second here. Let me get to this next part. Okay, guys, I'm going to try to go through this next part as cleanly as I can. This is kind of an experimental setup that I have here. The next part is, of course, this Shiva setup here and all the other cosplays that were going along with the event. Let me turn off the sound here so it doesn't sound weird. Okay. And you see Sir Amric over there in the corner. I think I got him too. There was a lot of cosplay I did not get. One being the Ramu, who was absolutely fantastic. Let me pull up this next one here. Oh, I got the Moogle. This guy was great. He was just bouncing around and being silly, and you probably saw the picture of him actually going on to the Fat Chocobo earlier. Let's go back to the next cosplay. Here's Sir Emmerich, which I got. And, you know, I every single time I got these guys to get into a picture for cosplay, I was like, hey, do something in your character. And so I think I told him to do that, and he's like, thumbs up, guy. You should do that more often. So the other cosplay that I got was this Moogle right here. I didn't get all the cosplay. I really wanted to get all the cosplay. But, I mean, if you guys... One of the things is they had the cosplay competition. If you guys really, really wanted to get into it, I would suggest purchasing the event. But then again, I know $30, holy crap, it's a lot of money. You don't want to spend it. But there are some really awesome VODs from it that, like, all the panels are worth it. All the panels plus the concert and everything else that you would get out of it are worth it. But we're used to free content, especially with events like this. And so it's kind of like, I don't want to spend the money for it. But if you want to be entertained, I would say it's, let's see, at least 10, 12 hours of entertainment, and you get minions in the game, so, I don't know, man. All right, you know, probably more than that. It's probably, let's see, start out 10, go to 8, 14, 28 hours, almost, of entertainment, plus 3 minions, just absorbing into all the stuff that happened with FanFest. So if you really, really are curious about it, then do it. Why not? Let's see. I want to get into the next one here. That was actually... Nope, that was all the cosplay I had. So I'm going to go on to some of these other events here that I had. And I think this is the one where I captured the wheel here. And I kind of sat here and where I was waiting for him to spin it. Nope, that was a short video here. Where's the one where... Yeah, here we go. Because I just wanted to see a picture of it being spinned around and everything else. And I had to wait here a little bit until they actually came up. And look at this wonderful FanFest employee here. Just checking my phone, hanging out. I don't know what to do. She might be on break. I don't know. And you can see... I can kind of make out some of the events here. Parties, Choice, No HUD. That's not so bad. Extremes, not so bad. Yeah, it's kind of hard to tell all these different events here. Party, Choice, Extreme. Yeah, all the ones you can read that are not in tiny print, I think were kind of easy. But they had a little iPad here that you could just kind of spin around and you could see what the next event. I think, what did these guys get? They got Containment Bay Minimum Eye Level S117. It's not bad. It's easy. One of the ones that I saw here was Layla, and he was doing, I think, Thornton Extreme. Let me pull this guy up. So I just sat there and put a camera in front of him for a little bit while he was doing it with his group. It was kind of fun to watch him. Too bad the audio messed up, but at a certain point that he, I think they cleared and he jumps up and he's excited and everything. He likes the Lakers, by the way, guys, if you didn't know that. So I don't want to fast forward it because you're going to miss it. There we go. This is what happens with World First, man. This is what he does when he gets World First. Cheers on like that. All right. So the next part of the section, I'm just going to show you guys the rest of the videos I have here because I got a whole bunch of different point of views of things, but I didn't really go into too much detail. And again, it's just we ran out of time. It was real frantic. There's lots of things going on, including my proposal to Kerr, or Kerberos, which if you guys didn't hear about it, I proposed to her right after the PvP event. Now, I did get some heat here about that, by the way. the biggest heat being that since I was on the PvP stage for the first round, everyone's like, yeah, you should have proposed to her here. You should have just went out there while all these thousands of people are watching you and propose. Knowing Kerr, that wouldn't have been a great decision. Later, I went back and I talked to her about it, and she's like, yeah, if you would have done that, I would have said no. But what am I going to do about it, right? So I did ask her privately. There's a lot of people. There's three people who proposed. There's one who proposed way before we did at the beginning of the event. There's one who proposed on stage. It was a scheduled thing right before the Primals concert. And then there was me. And yes, she said yes, by the way. She said yes, so it's good. But that's all personal stuff with me. You don't got to talk about that. But doing the PvP event was kind of weird, too. I wish I had more shots of that, but unfortunately I was in the PvP event. This is the Fat Chocobo, by the way. The PvP event was basically, they got the teams together. They organized all of this stuff. They said, all right, anyone who wanted to sign up for it, sign up for it. And after you got signed up, you would go set up all your controls and everything, and they would save the data, and then they would put it on the stage computers when it was your time to go up there with all the HUD settings and everything else. And there's a couple things that didn't quite transfer over, but overall it was a good idea. And I didn't know I was going to go on stage for that. And for those who are unfamiliar with what we did with PvP, I did Spears Out for Harambe, hashtag Spears Out for Harambe, with really great friends, World Champ from, which I actually did FanFest events with last time, and he came back this year. And then also another one, I can't remember his in-game name, but he's Mike to me. He's not Happy, but a different Mike. And also his friend, we all went together. We did a little bit of practice beforehand in the feast area. Man, look at that guy. This is a great picture. That guy's just looking straight at me. Ooh, let's see if I can just get it go to four a little bit. Maybe he stops looking up. Yep, he's like, okay, good. All right, much better. But yeah, I didn't get on the Fat Chocobo either. I felt kind of bad about that there. I think there's a pretty good line going on for that. And I wish I had time for it, but again, I ran out of time for all these different things. So let's go back here. Oh, here's Titan, by the way, if you guys were curious about him. He made a really good cosplay, but he didn't win. And it was kind of hard for him to move around too, I think. In that, let me see if I can fast forward a little bit. Yeah, no, it was really dark. I don't know what happened, but the lighting just went completely kaboot there. Kaput. But he had a pretty damn good costume, and I'm sure he spent a lot of time with it. Eventually, another person won. I won't tell you who, just in case you are curious and you're actually going to go watch it and you want a little bit of anticipation with who might win. So, Elia, if you're curious, here is the Spears Out for Harambe event, or otherwise known as the Piercing Talon, where you threw Nerf spears at the wall here and you tried to make it into the hole. I never really saw anyone who actually made it into the hole here. You can see, look at the wonderful condition. This is like at the very beginning of the event. You can see that these things are already kind of bent up and not so great. But it's okay. I mean, I think it was still fun. I think the staff members felt kind of bad. And even if you didn't get one in, they would like sneak you an extra stamp. Which was nice of them, I guess, in their own way. So, I don't think I... Did I move... yeah, I just moved the camera around for a different angle at this one. The other part here... Let's see... Oh, yeah, okay. So, one of the last things I want to talk about before we actually go into the... okay. One of the last things I want to talk about before we go into the actual show is how, like, the trouble that we went through to try to make the show happen. But before we do that, I forgot I had this one, which is kind of adorable here. You can see everyone signing their name on the board here. But one person is a little too short, didn't have enough room, and they wanted to go up to the top. So this happened. And I feel bad because maybe some of the names that wrote up on there got kind of smeared off in this whole process. But I think she got up there and she got her name and she's just like, no, and fell down. But that was pretty adorable. I can't read her name, so if you wanted to troll her, I don't know if you can troll her from there. So, the next part of this, I figured might be kind of interesting for you to listen to. I don't know if you, I'll have it, you listen to it, but we're setting up and we tried to find different locations here. And first, we're going to have a spot here. And again, the wonderful Layla here with me. Then we have Gouka in the middle. If you guys haven't seen Gouka before, that's what Gouka looks like. Amazing. Then we have Balana there with the amazing, wonderful beard. And Layla has a pretty stern look at me right now. I think right now we were kind of behind one of the mini events that was closed off at that point. And we're just going to kind of do this because we're like, hey, this is a good backdrop. But off to the side, people were over there arguing and yelling and everything else. And I'm pretty sure this is the video that we had where they were going crazy. It might not be. See how stupid I look? Oh my god. I know, I think we started doing it, and then like... They started, as soon as we started doing it, they start screaming over there. If I remember right. Yeah, see, I just kind of stop. And so the members off to the side, the FanFest guys are just over there just screaming. And I don't really know what to do in that situation. We're like, okay, let's get the fuck out. I'm done. We're not doing this. This might be the other portion here. No, that was where the big noise happened. This is, you can see Layla and all of them looking off to the side. And they're like, what the fuck? Yoka's like, this is odd. They just keep screaming. They're pushing each other over. And I wish we kind of turned the camera over to the side so you could see that they were put, like the panel behind us, there was another one over there where they were, and it was falling over because they were just like knocking each other around and acting like complete idiots. And I lost it at that point. I didn't know what else to do. I kind of, you can see Layla's like got this like blood rushing through his head. He's about to want to go over there and just like hit him in the face. But Layla's a good guy. He's not going to do it. He's not going to run over there and kill him. But in the end, we did have a show. And it was actually a pretty interesting show. I liked it a lot. I'm glad we did it. And I'm sorry if this whole first part was kind of boring. I try to just take you guys a little bit more into FanFest if you guys missed out on it. I wanted to record a couple of the events and just kind of show you what was going on with everything. And hopefully it was a little bit better of an insight for you. If it was boring, my bad. I try my best. And I'm working with this new green screen. Hopefully that worked out pretty well. But I'm not going to waste any more of your time here. We're going to go to the next part here where we are actually going to have our conversation. Where we had actually a little bit of a special guest pop in. I didn't know it at the time. We had random people walking down the hallway and everything else. But we made it work. So I hope you guys enjoy that part of it. And thank you guys for listening to me rambling for however long this has been so far. And enjoy the show. See you guys. Okay. Welcome to MogTalk. This is episode, I believe, 82 now. It's hard to keep track of it. It's been an exhausting couple of days here at FanFest. We're doing a very special episode here with some wonderful guests. And I'm going to start actually on this side, two guests that have been on the show before, and you've seen their faces. So we're going to go down the line here and then end on our mystery guest. First off, we have the wonderful, very, very repetitive on the show. I guess that's the wrong way to say it, right? I should say, like, very reoccurring guest.
I've been on the show about, I think this is the eighth or ninth time.
You really?
Quite a few times. Hey, Balana, come on the show.
Yeah.
And, you know, it usually works out. We have a good show. It's a good time. Never gonna say no to you, Frosty.
All right. I got some questions
that's
for you.
That's a dangerous statement.
Yeah. Okay, so I want to ask you a quick intro question for you. All right, yeah. The one thing I want to ask is just how is FanFest? How are you feeling right now? Are you exhausted or?
FanFest is amazing. It's meeting all these people you've like met online, and they're all coming into one place, and everybody has something to talk about with each other because you're all here for a common reason. So it's a pretty surreal experience, like meeting all these people that you've known maybe for years, like just through instant messaging or from the characters in the game, and some like giant dude walks up to you, is like, "Hi, yes, I'm Bella Thorne." I'm the cat girl in the game. Like, cool. Yeah, that's awesome.
White guy walks up to you. Hi, I'm Layla.
Nice. Of course, our second guest here is Layla Bell, also known as Klops.
Yes.
Yep.
Hello.
Hey, what's up?
I'm glad to be here, man.
You are?
It's good to see you.
Dude,
we've been hanging out a lot.
Oh,
this
my
weekend.
Gosh.
This guy's a good guy.
We've had very many sitting around drinking and talking.
Yes.
The shits.
The midnight lounge.
Yeah.
Hangouts have been good.
Yeah.
But so. I'm glad to be here, man. I'm glad we got to meet up and do this, have this live mob talk. Yeah. It should be a lot of fun.
Are you enjoying everything so far?
Yeah.
Well, are you exhausted?
Not exhausted yet. I was maybe getting there this morning, but after a nice, you know, rejuvenating lunch, I'm back up to speed. Mm-hmm. You know, we just got the Primal concert coming up in maybe like an hour.
Yeah.
So we're all really stoked for that.
It's going to be hardcore.
And yeah, man, I'm just loving FanFest. I'm loving this weekend.
It's been great, man. Now, we have one secret guest here, maybe secret to some people, that you haven't seen his face before. He's been on the show once. He is the world-renowned player, Gouka, leader of Elysium. How are you doing, buddy?
I am so fucking tired. I didn't sleep the night before, and that entire night someone was actually convincing me to go to FanFest. And then, funny story, I got my keys, but I didn't remember the room number that Cy and Rosie gave me. So I spent all night going up and down the elevator, slotting different doors, trying to get into the room. But I only checked the right side. I did not check the left side, which was my fatal error. I should have listened to Beyonce.
Nice.
So I didn't sleep till 4 a.m. that night. And then last night I was also up pretty late. We had a Gilgamesh Korean barbecue.
That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Huge turnout. Yeah. If you went to that, you're awesome.
Yeah. All right. Well, are you enjoying FanFest besides that?
I am enjoying it. And okay. I will shout out to Kung Fury for popping my alcoholic cherry.
That is still something that's super surprising to me. We won't go too much into that because our show is not about the alcoholism that will be your future. It's more of it's just
after this weekend.
Maybe, yeah. I don't think I've had a night without excessive drinking so far. So today's show, we're just going to kind of talk about a few different things, and we have point of views from one of the most amazing FCs that I've ever spoken to. All of the members that I've had on the show have been pretty awesome so far. And of course, our world first, until very recently, world first warrior here, Layla Bell, two times in a row. We have Balana, the most common MogTalk guest so far. I think common's not a good word for you. You're not a common person.
Recurring,
yeah. Okay, I'm going to find a good word for it. It's not going to sound
just
so
just don't say redundant.
Redundant,
that's
yeah.
That's not the word you want to use.
Yeah, but no, very awesome, insightful, Balana. And then the amazing FC leader of Elysium.
Just okay. A man.
Yeah. So the reason I have you guys on the show is I respect all of your opinions a great bit. The really interesting thing is there's been a couple of announcements here at FanFest. A couple.
Yeah.
Just a few. And you guys are pretty serious Final Fantasy XIV players, and I want to kind of get your point of view on what you think about all these different announcements. The very first thing that I actually want to jump into is the announcement of Stormblood. The trailer, they didn't really give us much, right?
No.
They gave us a cinematic.
They gave me enough.
They gave you enough?
They gave me
two
enough.
Two sexy mid laners, that's all you need.
Okay, excellent. What's your thing with mid laners, by the way?
Everything else sucks. Mid laners the best.
Okay, just plain out.
I'm all out there, you know?
Aren't they? They're the most human race, right?
Yeah, they're most human, most humane, and they get 15% extra crit if you roll mid laner. It's not listed in the game features, but if you go mid laner, you will get 15% extra crit rate.
This is how rumors start.
Gouka, come on, man. Come on. People learning watch this show. You give them false information.
That's his goal, to get them to roll a mid laner. To con them.
Yeah, I am bettering their lives.
Fair enough. Okay, so we saw that. A lot of people have been speculating about what, you know, the job was that was the female counterpart to the little battle they were having there. Some people just think it's monk.
It's a monk.
It's just a monk? You think it's just a monk?
I think it might be. Here's my crazy theory, is that before we got ninja, we had, who was it? It was Fancred doing like ninja stuff. So before we got Ninja, we had that. Now we got Yida doing some like sort of dancer stuff here and there. So maybe there's a glimmer of hope. Possibly might be out there.
Yeah. What do you think, buddy?
I think those are just two miners.
Okay. Two miners. The ones that mine things, right?
That's yeah.
Okay, good, good, good.
They're at a rocky place. That's where you get rocks.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough.
Most convincing argument we've actually heard this weekend.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I think it is possibly Dancer, and I don't know why they wouldn't have announced it, but it looks like Dancer, just maybe just the counterpart to Monk, an off branch of it. Like if you were going to go Pugilist, you know how Summoner and Scholar works, go up and then...
Assuming they're even keeping that multiple job per class... Mm-hmm. System that they had going on with Arcanist, which I don't think they like. I think that I remember reading.
Oh, yeah.
I remember reading a long time ago that they wanted to get away from that like scholar summoner separation over Arcanist. So I would be really surprised if they brought that back in the Pugilist.
Yeah, I mean, I would be surprised too with that, but it really looks that way. Maybe he'll just come out and officially say, "Yeah, Monk," and then okay, whatever. Not that interesting then. So. I guess going past that, we didn't really see too much out of that, except for like, oh, look, it looks really pretty. We see a huge statue. I think the statue is the main...
It's Rolgar.
Is it Rolgar?
Statue of Rolgar.
Okay.
It's Rolgar. I have it as my elemental affinity, so I know this.
We also got exciting announcements, like the level cap is increasing.
I love leveling.
There's going to be new raids, and...
They have to announce that stuff. It's like obvious stuff, yeah, right? Yeah. But they have to announce it.
Everyone expected we were going to be leveling to 70. I don't think there was a single person that didn't.
Yeah.
The biggest hype moment in the room, though, was when they said inventory expansion.
Yeah.
It's actually not true. It was the second biggest hype moment.
Okay,
The first... The first biggest hype moment in the room was when they announced they were dropping PS3 limitations.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty close. Pretty close between those two.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of that being an excuse why the game can't be better. Them getting rid of PS3 is a big thing for me. And it was pretty obvious when they were doing it because they were like, hey, we're upping the minimum specs. Well, how do you do that?
Yeah, I know, right? everyone knew it was coming. Like our whole row in the audience was just like, just put it out of its misery. Just stop dragging it on, man. Just put the knife in it.
Yeah. Gouka, what are your thoughts on them getting rid of PS3?
My thoughts are that some players I knew started on PS3. The majority of them sucked, so I'm not sad to see. I'm just kidding. That would be cool, actually. Yeah. I think it's really good.
Yeah.
I was honestly disappointed when they didn't discontinue it on the first expansion, because I knew that there were going to be people who would continue to play on it, and I knew that it was reaching a bottleneck, and... It was going to disappoint them later down the line when they were more invested in the game. So I had wished they had done this sooner so that it was a quicker cutoff and that by now we would be able to see advances without disappointing a bunch of players.
Right. And by the way, guys, if you're hearing noises in the background, people walking by, elevators beeping and everything, we're in the center of like an area of hotel. So
one of the hotel towers in Paris,
But this is much better than the other places we picked because every other spot had... people pushing each other over are loud drums. So we're doing okay.
Or fighting.
Yeah, the pushing people over, knocking over like big banners and stuff like this.
Yeah.
What happens behind the scenes, right?
Yeah, the stuff that goes on behind the stream.
Yeah. Okay, so I guess moving forward past that, one of the interesting things that I thought was that they were discussing that they're going to simplify the jobs. They've already said this a bit. But they said it's pretty much going to be a rework of the system. That's kind of a risky move when you think about it, because they could horribly mess everything up. Or it could be good because they just make it simple enough to where it's really hard to mess up, but then it's too simple. I mean, what are your thoughts on that announcement where they said they're going to rework it?
What I've seen so far, I actually really, really like. So when they talk about making cross classes assigned to roles, I think that is the smartest direction they could have taken this, because when you think about it, every role in the game has to satisfy some minimal requirement. You know, tanks need to be able to provoke off each other, tanks need to be able to grab aggro from AoEs or single targets, they have to have a threat combo. You know, there are basic requirements in each role, and I think if I understand Square Enix correctly, I think what they're doing is they're saying, okay, you have this base core of skills that these classes need to have, and then we can use everything else as sort of an extra filler to diversify them. I think that's the best way to approach it.
More unique.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm trying to make sure I understand it too. With tanks and healers, they said they're limited to tanks, healers, and like melee DPS and range.
I actually don't know if that's true. I don't know what they said.
Role specific is what they're trying to do, like what they're explaining. Is that,
right.
You know, for if you're a ranged DPS, you're going to have access to these skills. You're going to have raging strikes, you're going to have cooling strikes, whatever you need there.
Melee. I mean, that's awfully specific for what we've been given.
So I mean, yeah. It's a little bit specific, but I mean, that seems to be what they're aiming for.
That's what we can speculate, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. At least that's what I was pulling from it. I mean, they may tell us something different later, but it's kind of interesting to think about it. And I mean, this is kind of a popular topic too, because a lot of people are not happy about them dumbing down skills and making it easier or whatever it may be. Being someone who is extremely hardcore serious about optimizing everything, how do you feel about that optimization being made easier?
I mean, okay, well, first of all, we need to preface that we don't know exactly what easier means to them.
Right.
There's a number of different ways you could interpret that. And my actual interpretation has changed over the course of FanFest. I went into this weekend thinking that, oh, well, they're just going to make the rotation simpler. Based on the conversations that, you know, Yoshi's given and some of the slides that we saw, I don't necessarily know if that's going to be the case. You know, they're going to remove some of the ineffective skills, like Featherfoot, yep. they showed Featherfoot, Faint, and Fracture were the three abilities that they showed. I wish they wouldn't give it a Fracture. It's my baby, but that's okay. Yeah. If they want to make something more interesting, I actually think Fracture's really uninteresting.
Yeah.
But I think it's very effective. Yeah. So, yeah, if they want to make something more interesting, then I'm for it. But they highlighted things like they want to make buffs like Blood of the Dragon more visible and more noticeable that you, so you don't have to focus on like a buff on the top of your screen or wherever you have your buff bar on your HUD. You know, when they're making these rotations simpler, they're trying to get away from like players struggling with maintaining these buffs like Blood of the Dragon or buffs like that they added in Heavensward.
Yeah,
they don't necessarily have to remove those if they just make them a little bit easier to manage by indicators or. You know, if you're familiar with World of Warcraft, they have you have power auras. You know, if they want to incorporate something like when they were explaining it on stage, my mind immediately went to, oh wow, they're gonna have power auras in the game.
Exactly.
Like when they have Blood of the Dragon, you know, your Blood of the Dragon hits 10 seconds or something, and a little blinking indicator pops up on your screen or something. You know, something like that.
Right.
So
right.
if that's what they mean by making the game easier, then I obviously don't have a problem with it.
Right.
It doesn't change my play style. If they, are working toward, making their actual rotations easier and simpler to not only come up with but also enact, then I don't necessarily have a problem with it. What they want to do for their games, fine with me. You know, at the end of the day, I'm still going to play it.
Yeah.
Like, I already think the warrior rotation is pretty simple. So like, if they just make simpler, it doesn't really matter to me very much.
Fair enough.
So yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, that's my stance. I'm going to play whatever they give me, and whatever makes the most people happy is what I want them to do.
Okay. That's a very good answer, by the way.
No. Thank you.
Yeah, no, good. Gouka, you have any input on that as well? Or
So simpler, in my mind, it could come down to the rotations and stuff. I think their biggest thing is understanding the game. When you start getting a really, really old game, and I'll give an example of this, WoW. I've never played WoW. And I don't intend to play WoW because there's so much backlog to it that if I started getting into it, I feel as if there's a lot of information for me to soak that I personally don't really care to invest in. And Final Fantasy might be getting to that point where people feel that there's way too much to invest in when they want to get into it. And so by simplifying it in terms of making it easier to understand, I think that might be a good direction for keeping the longevity of the game.
Yeah. No, I actually agree, and I've talked about this a handful of times, is that when they come out with this next expansion, they have to make sure that people want to play it because that looks like a really cool expansion
yes.
that they want to play. So you got to throw in stuff like old Final Fantasy fans that never touched 14 or gave it a chance, like, oh yeah, that's cool, I like that, I want to fight this person, or I want to do this thing. And the main reason I think of this is, I mean, I'll go back to WoW, which is a little bit of a different story. You know, that when Arthas came out, that was the peak. of WoW.
Yeah, one of them, I would say. Yeah. One of the peaks, yes.
Well, I mean, that's when, like, most of the player base, like, I think it hit its highest,
it was
right?
It high subscription rate.
Was it higher than Odin?
Yeah, it was higher than Burning Crusade. Wrath went higher than a Burning Crusade. They had, I think, 13, 14 mil around then.
Yeah, I think BC peaked at, like, 11 or something.
Yeah. Still pretty close, but...
And so it was really awesome to see that happen. I don't know how they would do that since the Final Fantasy 14 is kind of its own universe, but they do incorporate other things from other Final Fantasies in constantly. So throwing these novelties in would be a good idea to bring more people, but also making it to when they come into the game, they're not going through 20 years of story.
3 years and of then, learning the game.
Yeah.
No, they go ahead.
They have said, like, after Heavensward, remember, you know, had to go through the 2.x story and all that over again. They have said they want to make it so Heavensward, you maybe don't need to do all of that, but it's going to be questionable how they're going to do that, but still make, you know, the story make sense for you. So maybe they'll make you skip, you can skip, like, the 3.0 to the 3.3 story and just pick up with the All Amigo chapter of what's going on. Yeah. So it's something they might pull off.
They've toyed with the idea of, you know, what do you call them, like, the leveling potions that are like really controversial. I don't know a good way to describe them, but
jump potion.
A jump potion, if that's a good way to put it. You know, and those work well in WoW because it gets the player who goes out and buys a new, you know, WoW's on its like sixth expansion or something at this point, gets the player who just went out and spent $40 to $50 on an expansion playing the new content with their friends rather than having to go through 10 years at this point worth of content to catch up and play with their friends. Like, there is merit to those things. And I know the majority of the community doesn't like jump potions, but...
I mean, if they did it correctly, I wouldn't mind it as much, just because it makes sense going forward with an MMO, but they have to do it in a way to where they don't just kind of throw you to, you know, the wolves. You could go out there and say, hey, you're going to level up at a very slow pace, but you're going to go through this simplified story and simplified everything, and you're going to learn every ability that we give you. And then
I think the best thing to do is to actually not go to the extremity of a jump potion and just instead, you know, make everything before Stormblood or something much more streamlined, get rid of all the filler quests, pump up the MSQ quest EXP reward so that, you know, you can just bang through the story and get it right into Stormblood. I think this is a game where, you know, the MSQ does kind of carry on from vanilla to... It did carry on from vanilla to Heavensward, so I'm imagining that it's going to carry on from Heavensward to Stormblood as well.
Yeah.
So, as a new player, you are going to kind of want to go through every iteration of the game's MSQ. But if they cut out all the... There's a lot of filler quests in this game. Yeah. Like, there's a lot of filler. If they cut out all that filler, I think it streamlines it enough.
Yeah. I think one of the biggest, like, issues is, like, when people try to cut out that filler, you're also dealing with... a lot of work that people put into the game, like with stories, little mini stories going off. Some of them are pretty good if you pay attention to them. Most people don't. Maybe if they just had a toggle option where you said only you toggle on extra quest. But all right, so guys, we're going to stop this portion right now, and we'll come back here in just a second and finish up the second portion. Thank you, guys. Yeah, me in the shop.
Do you want to stand here and I'll stand on the sides?
Well, I was thinking of doing that, but I could also be on the side here. Holy fuck.
I know.
Do
you want to
find somewhere a little bit quiet?
Hopefully it's pretty quiet over here, but we'll find out. And maybe if it gets loud later, then maybe not.
I'm trying to be a little bit loud so I can be obvious.
Okay. You good? Welcome back, guys. Frosty here for part two, I suppose, of this episode. We got a few more questions we want to get through before we end this part of it. One of the biggest things, since you guys are all pretty serious raiders, is what do you guys think about how they've introduced, or what information they've given us, I guess, so far going to 4.0 for raids?
Well,
no name.
They actually haven't given us a lot, which I mean was expected. I don't think any of us came here expecting to know much about the 4.0 raids. What they have done is they've teased us with a lot of potentials, and one of the hottest things that they've teased us with is the idea of a third difficulty.
Yeah. To be released like in the odd number patches between. Just kind of like to keep that hardcore community.
Like super. Well, and that would be not a bad idea. I guess. But I mean, I've had conversations about putting three difficulties in there and thinking it's kind of ridiculous. I guess it gives you guys something.
There are ways they can make it work. It does require a lot more commitment, I will say. You know, taking that time off work, taking that time off school. You're now doing it twice as frequently if they want to go that route of adding like brutal or super savage on the odd number patches. It works well in other MMOs.
It worked well with Coil, right?
Yeah, I think it did work well in Coil.
At least the second Savage Coil model.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where you have that come out later on, you have maybe like a title in it. It's not like a new tier of gear or anything. So it's less work on them on their art department. It's just tuning the fights they had before, so they could crank that out potentially in the in-between times.
Yeah.
But still keep the three difficulty.
Exactly.
So, 4.0 could be normal and then Savage, and maybe that Savage is more akin to like the 3.4 difficulty that we just went through with Creative.
Right.
And then, in 4.1 or something, you have this resurgence of second Coil Savage difficulty where it's tuned for maximum item level. And they just don't care what they throw at you.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, I think that's a good thing, is that if that didn't give you gear, but gave you something, I think there probably should be something that gives you, like, some sort of vanity.
They need more incentive. Yeah. Where they failed with 2.3 Second Coil Savage is there was not enough incentive to get the mass populace interested. You had the hardcore of the hardcore interested just because they wanted the challenge, but it really didn't draw in anybody other than that. I can count on one hand how many groups actually strived for clearing all four fights in 2.3.
Yep. Gouka?
I'm not a big fan of a three-tier system, personally. And the main reason, one of the reasons is crafted gear. Right now, crafted gear plays a large role in progression, and it's really good for the crafters. And I'm wondering how that's going to fit into a model where the extreme version comes after the normal version and, medium core version have released. If you're supposed to be using gear from those to complete the Savage version, because I assume that people will care less about the medium core and soft core race and more about the hardcore race. And that means that crafted gear is going to be less important for hardcore raiders, which means less money into crafted.
Well, I mean, sort of. I don't know. I would still kind of care about all of that, because it would be like every 3 months there's a race, right?
Yeah, I would usually about 3 to 4 months, yeah. I think that, like, as far as crafted gear goes, as long as they tune the fights to require the crafted gear to clear the new content, like week one, it's going to incentivize people to get it. Because the quicker you're clearing those fights, the quicker you're getting gear, getting preparing for your best in slot for the 4.1 tier that's coming up. Like there is a value in clearing the fights as soon as possible so that you can have your best in slot, like ready to go for the super savage.
Well, that's the other thing. Having the gear ready to go for the Super Savage. What I really like about crafted gear is that it allows players who may have missed a tier to kind of jump in next tier. They're not going to get the first two turns, maybe, but they're going to be able to get in if they're a really good player and not have to worry about, oh, last minute I'm switching jobs to Bard or I'm switching jobs to Dragoon.
I'll tell you what. 4.1, they release new crafted gear that matches the item level of the other two difficulties of whatever the new raid's going to be.
That would also be very nice.
Oh, that kind of cuts down on the whole stepping stone thing they've been doing, though, with like World of Darkness and the 24-man raids being like, it would be 260 gear would be the ones that would be coming out in 3.5 here. So you kind of, if you release crafted gear at what was the cap before, you're kind of eliminating that one step forward, one step back in gear item level that they've been doing since.
One step forward and one step backward?
Well, you got to go forward and back and forward and back.
Yeah.
So when's the step forward?
It's expansions.
Oh, okay.
But one thing, the way I think I would prefer to see them go about it is to have a systemized structure of nerfing on turns. So what they could do is say, you have the Savage turn, and they have a structure where they know they can implement nerfs very quickly and in an efficient manner to cut down on development usage. That's the biggest concern for me, is making sure that it doesn't cost a lot of developer time, and making sure that... a lot of the player base can do it, because at the end of the day, players are gonna, if it has something, players are gonna want to do it.
Yeah.
And
I'm gonna go ahead and say, I don't know if you guys are around the QA section. Did you watch the QA at all?
I was in the venue. I just wasn't seated.
Did you see the QA?
I didn't catch too much of it.
I was there. Yeah.
I was waving my arms like a madman.
Really?
Begging to get
that person to come over and let me ask. I was going to ask about.
Here's your podium.
Okay, Yoshi P. I respect a lot of things you do. I would like to know if and when you would ever decide to add in hardcore Savage Raid achievements.
No.
Yes, but if I just wanted to ask that question because everyone was asking, when am I going to get a new hairstyle? When am I going to be able to edit this? When can I change my glamour up? Please let me talk about raids just once. I just want to have a conversation.
Here's what he's going to say. He's going to be like, sa, kimochi ga wakaru ka.
Okay, Koji, what do you say?
He's Koji.
Koji, what do you say?
He has three limitations.
He has three. No, limitations ga.
Oh, maybe PS5.
Hi.
Okay. That was really bad. But no,
it's
yeah.
Okay, we can cut that.
We could cut it if we want to cut it. Maybe we'll keep it in there for fun. But I think this is actually probably going to be able to wrap up the show because we have to get seats for the Primal Concert.
Yes.
Too. Oh, yeah.
Yes.
And so like we're running out of time.
We're still FanFest guests right now.
Yeah, we're still guests. I wanted to just get this interview. It was supposed to be a little bit quicker, but we had to travel to make this interview actually happen. So thank you guys for watching this segment. Maybe I'll have more segments later on. We'll see. I have had a wonderful time here. Anything before?
This guy's awesome.
Frost is the best.
No.
And so are the viewers for watching this.
Yes.
Me and viewers. Kakashi from Angered have names from Naruto.
That was a good way to end that.
Yeah.
Perfect. And as you guys can see, they all have MogTalk shirts on.
Yep.
Everyone
has to represent these shirts.
Yeah, yeah.
These awesome, the awesome shirts that Frosty prepared for us.
Yeah. I'm there, so
I don't know if the Moogle was in the shot, but...
That was awesome. Yeah, it was good.
Fantastic.
And these are all for guests that came to FanFest that have been on the show before. It's been a pleasure having you guys on the show.
It's been a pleasure being on your show.
Fun, guys.
I tell you all the time, man. You put on a great show, and I'm glad you take an interest in us and bring us on.
One day I'll believe you, man. But thank you guys for watching the show. Until next time, you guys, be good. Be good, keep cool, stay frosty.
Oh!
All right, awkward wave. Let's do it.